Okay, so basically we are using DSpace, and we have actually modified it a lot according to our needs and according to the needs of the client centers. So today we are first going to talk about DSpace, and I'm going to give an overview of DSpace, how what it is, how it works, and then we talk about what are the modifications that we did and what are the features we are offering. Then we will going to talk a little bit about how you can install that, what things you required, maybe a little bit of demo and configuration, and then it will be more about CloudNB Center and what are the requirements of CloudNB Centers, how you can achieve that, and how our repository can help you achieve that. This will be the outline of today's tutorial. So basically, DSpace is a repository management system widely used in academics, especially. It's used in more than 1,000 institutions, and it's actually a platform that offers you to capture all kind of formats, whether audio, video, text, and it allows you to distribute it over the web. The features are that it gives the ability to index it, and then it provides you to search it, and the users can actually download the resources. The main part is that it not only stores the resources, but it also stores the metadata about the resources. So it defines what the resources are so that other repositories can actually harvest them. It's easy to find and it's easy to cite. Then it also provides customizable workflows. So you can actually define how you want to collect the data from the users, what are the different stages. If you want to curate them, you can actually define different workflows in which you can actually do editing and quality control. Then it's actually an open source community, so there are lots of developers around. You can ask questions, you can get help from the community, which is actually a good point. So basically, in short, DSpace has got all the ingredients that we need to set up a repository in a CloudNB center. That's why we started to use it. There are lots of things that were not there or not according to our requirements. So that's why we started to develop a lot of features that can actually fit in the CloudNB center. So this is actually an overview of the architecture of the DSpace. So there are lots of layers in that. You have an item, a submitter can submit the deposit the resources in various stages. Then there is a whole management team in which there are editors, curators, and administrators. Then there is end user who wants to retrieve and search those resources. So this is the whole picture, but I'm going to talk about a little bit of them. So basically, if you want to submit a resource, there are easy to use web-based forms, and you can actually customize the forms, what you want to get from the user, what kind of metadata you want to associate with different resources. This is all actually customizable, very easy to configure within the DSpace. Then it provides metadata registries. You can actually create your registries. You can use different formats. And DSpace basically stores each item as a bundle. So there are bundle for metadata, bundle for your bit streams, and then it packages everything into one item. And then furthermore, you can actually categorize the item into collections and communities to better maintain and better curate them. So you can assign items to different communities, and then you can actually assign workflows to different collections and communities. Each collection can have different workflows. If you want that someone submit an item, and then the item should go to an editor or a curator to actually check the quality of the metadata, or you directly want the item to go to the repository, this all can be defined very easily in a workflow. Then for the end user, DSpace provides a very easy to use interface in which all the data and the resources are together in item view. You can search very easily using different criterias, and this is all part of DSpace. So what actually we did? We actually enhance each and every aspect in various ways. For example, first come the interface. So we really develop a new theme for the DSpace, which is very sleek, very nice looking. Then we enhance the submission workflow. We enhance the forms that a user can use to fill in the data, because we were using this repository for quite some time now, and it goes through various iterations. And now we know that what exactly user needs to submit. And now we actually use only those items, and they're very prominent in our repository, that you need a licensing framework, you need this metadata. This metadata is more relevant, so it's come first and then it comes second. So we have developed all these workflows, the submission forms that are already now part of our repository, and you can use that.
And that is based on a SIMD profile that is a specific SIMD profile,
yes,
that you use?
Yeah.
But you can replace that?
Yeah, you can edit anything you like. You can add new metadata, you can add new profiles. It's all up to you.
Can you use multiple profiles, or is there basically one profile for the whole DSpace?
Yeah, you can use multiple profiles as well. You can use combination of profiles as well.
So maybe just a few more technical details. So maybe I will repeat what already Amir said, but we store metadata in a key value pairs. Okay, we are supporting like hierarchy to one level, something like that. Basically, it's a key and value pair. The key is what we semantically understand, and for example, sometimes you see like dc.author.firstname or something like that. We know internally what that means. There are also local.something, and because we know what that means, we can convert these metadata to different output formats like the CMDI or DC or OLAC or a couple of that, because we are using the submission workflow, which means we already tell the user what he has to input there. We are sure that we can convert them to those different formats because we always require a title. So we know that OLAC profile requires a title, so we will fulfill the requirements and we will have a nice OLAC metadata format. But basically, it's a key value pair, which you have to somehow put into this space. For us, it's the submission workflow, and then different conversions. The conversions are basically XSL transformation, so we can really choose any CMDI profile that we meet the requirements of the required data.
So that needs to be rather flat, isn't it?
Yes. Well, it does not need to be flat, but the metadata what we have are flat or up to one hierarchy.
Yeah.
Level.
So if I have like multiple authors and they have names and so on, but you will have only key value pairs. How do you know which key value belong to the same?
That's what I said, that up to one level we have some components exactly for this. So when there will be component like offer first name, offer second name, we can store that.
Okay.
If the component would be multiple levels, so inside that component there would be another component saying the organization, which would have the name, the telephone, the address, we can't do that.
Okay.
Or at the move, we could implement it, but that's
it
not
be
our
very
goal.
Elegant, basically.
No. Exactly.
We struggled a lot also with the MetaShare conversion, since the cardinality, for instance, if you have multiple licenses and so on, and you need to choose, okay, should I do two items out of this, one with this, or should we try to squash the two licenses into the same item? That was one of the questions we needed to resolve for us.
We have already experienced this, and basically we took two approaches. We try to look at the user, and when the user comes and he sees 10 licenses, you know, for us, we said, well, that's probably not what we want to do. Even technically, we can assign licenses to each of the files. But we said, no, there will be only one license for the whole submission. Mm-hmm. So it's clear for the user when he wants to acknowledge, accept the license, he will only have to click once, mm-hmm. not 20 times. If the user or if the submitter wants to have multiple, he has two choices, split them. Mm-hmm. Or then we have something called with like a meta license. Mm-hmm. When there is corpora with 20 licenses, then we just create one license saying, this corpora has this license, but he accepts the main license, only the one.
I think this use case in MetaShare and some datasets is like when open source software has this double licensing option that you can either have it under GPL or under some commercial license. We don't have such datasets, but I can see that sometimes you might want it, but we haven't come across the situation.
No, I just brought it up since it's definitely in the same area.
But it means basically that if you have legacy data which can be profiled, if you start afresh, you can probably accommodate this because you start with this restriction.
So we basically, started fresh. So So what we mostly do is when somebody comes up with something that we consider a crazy idea, we talk to them, change their minds. You don't want double licensing. Think about it.
And our experience is really that the user usually doesn't understand licenses. So when we talk to him, he just decides. There were some cases, legacy data, like, okay, the authors are not anymore among us or whatever, so we can't change it. So we have to accommodate, or we have done some changes for that, but those are really, really only exceptional cases. That's the submitter case when he doesn't understand licenses, but the user as well. When you give the user the right to just choose between licenses, usually he's much more confused. This is our experience, at least.
I frankly believe it would be a best choice to have data with double licensing.
The licensing is one issue, but it just means about. I'm talking more about the complexity of a SIMD profile. And of course, you can have average user, a very simple SIMD profile is better. But
I think that basically speaking, I think that this repository system is not a great choice if what you think if you decide that what you need is this incredible huge CMDI metadata and maybe some data with it. So this is very much for the other use case where you are centered on the data and you want some sensible basic metadata about
that's in a way our policy, but at the end of the day we have done there one feature which allows to serve any CMDI in OAI PMH. Okay. So basically I think we agree that CMDI for a user just to display that doesn't make any sense. Or most of the time, it's not really, when you would see it in a text file or somewhere, it has to, the application has to have some support for it. Like in a component registry, you can click on that, you can see what's really inside it. But what we do is, because we have had a lot of questions about, okay, but we have already the CMD file. Yeah. So in that case, we suggest that still go through the submission workflow or extract the required information, what we require, the title, the offer, and hopefully it will be there. Upload then the CMDI file to the submission workflow with an ending.cmdi. Check one box saying serve this file when OAI PMH comes. So we can have a robust CMDI file served by the OAI PMH endpoint, but in a way it's against our policy, and mostly it's because we don't have CMDI metadata, which we had to put there. That's our reasoning for that, but the feature is there. Okay. You can do that, but again, we rely on the required metadata so the search engine works, so the displaying is consistent. If you can extract that or provide that,
is it Yeah, maybe we can discuss it by the end, because there are some modifications of this system that are done explicitly for this reason by Polish guys and by the guys in Norway, who want more richer metadata, and they integrated it with some CMDI editors. But the basic system by itself, because DSpace includes, that includes the front end, that includes how the indexes are done, how the searching is done, that uses Solr. That is simply not a great fit for arbitrary hierarchies of CMDI.
I can say what we did for that. Basically, we do the same with Fedora. Also requires that you have some .NET core, and we just come with SIMD. So we provide you always have to provide an XSLT that maps your profiles to at least the title and description. Yeah. But then the arbitrary facets that you fill in the Solr, you can use basically what the VLO does. You give it a mapping file, and based on the mapping, he concept links or explicit X paths, he can fill from the profiles the facets. Basically.
Yeah, which, so mean, which means that you find some compromise arbitrary with the flexibility.
Yeah.
Because whenever a user decides to create their own profile, you don't have a quick searching of
no,
those.
No, but what we
facets
have is that. And what you have the same, you hit the editor or the collection manager, and he gets a signal, hey, new profile. You have to look, where does it fit? Does it will it fill all the right facet values and so on? So at the moment you see a new profile, which will not happen that often, you will have to do something extra or have to check something. But in principle, you can have this mapping working.
Yeah.
So I think you can still cope quite a lot with the flexibility of SIMD in a general system, as long as you have the mappings.
Right. We put this burden in a way to the submitter, and well, that's also because of the sustainability. We wanted to have a system which can be sustained with minimal like manpower, you know, and also without the knowledge of SIMD, for example. So we put this burden to the submitter. So he has to somehow either through the command line or through the submission workflow to put the information there to do the mapping.
That sounds like the wrong side, because who is the one that should know a bit about SIMD and metadata models?
No, but when you have the metadata, but when you have the metadata, you definitely have to know what's the title and what's the submitter and so on, and we have only these. So for us, again, our idea was CMD are great, but they have to be created by librarians or kind of by users who know what they should do. And for us, we did it for them, the basic metadata. And again, if they want to serve their own CMD, they can, but we require this set of metadata values. And if you give that, then you can then serve the CMD however you want.
I think that we can really discuss the SIMD details by the end if we have time for it, but I just want to say so far the experience on our side was, okay, we are really trying to provide something that is simple that users understand, including the submitters. So we are really happy not to even use the word CMDI anywhere for the submitters. They have no idea that such a thing exists. And so far we have not had one user asking us for more granular metadata. So we've been using it, 5 years, 6 years, running the repository.
Yeah, I think it depends.
And if the submitters have some questions about metadata, they sometimes do, it's why there are so many attributes?
Exactly.
Why do I have to fill so much? And can you make it somehow easier to fill in? So we are really concentrating on, and I think you will show it, on improvements of the submission workflow usability, and not in the way of providing more flexibility if that case comes, well, that's our general approach to anything in the repository. If there comes a request to have some additional functionality, we will think about it. So far the requests are not going in this way,
but
so we are not doing anything
depending a bit on your application. Like we, for example, we have a lot of the repositories, basically they're mainly for the collection managers and to have the persistent storage, and the metadata and the upload is actually not, the users in general will not upload directly in the system. They will come from a VRE, And the VREs can have a very dedicated SIMD profile for the specific type of resources that the VRE understands. And with that means that depending on how many VREs and so on, you can have many different SIMD profiles that enter your.
I think that Amer will show it. Our repository is very much user-facing, like, thing.
Okay, but definitely this is topic for discussion we can have afterwards, because it's interesting, and as Pavel said, there are other centers who have tried to solve these issues, but let's continue.
Yeah. So, as Pavel and Joseph already told you that we have gone through with a number of iterations in our submission workflow, so we had a lot of metadata in the beginning. But users didn't like that, so we reiterate that and we try to reduce the burden on the user as much as possible. So now we have the minimum things that are from the user interface. So we want users to actually come and submit their resources. We don't want to just make them afraid and go away. So that's why we try to make the submission forms very simple and try to ask them things that are really required, and you can see later what I'm talking about. So the other parts that we actually enhance is we provided a very powerful control panel. The DSpace default control panel was not very robust and it was very limited, so we added a functionality in such a way that you can add your own control panel tabs, and this functionality is also now part of DSpace. And we actually provided more tabs that are very useful for management purposes. So there is logging management, there is user management, and there is bitstream management and license management and these kind of things. Then we have a advanced licensing framework, and we are going to see that how easily you can add new licenses, and you can actually add many features with the licenses. You can ask users extra information, extra metadata when they are signing the licenses, and you can do that. Then we have provided better statistics. We have Pivik statistics, Google statistics. I'm going to show you that. And then we also work a lot with the authentication and authorization infrastructure, and we enhance that a lot. So first, let's talk about the interface. So this is how our repository actually look like. So we have created the whole theme based on Bootstrap, which is a widely used CSS and JavaScript library. So it's very responsive, mobile friendly. The look is very nice. It's interactive, most of the things that user needs are, so the whole design is user-centric. And we have gone through a number of iterations also on the UI, and is still developing the UI regularly. Then the next thing is easy to access. So we have relied heavily on the Shibboleth. We have configured Shibboleth, and then we have integrated the Shibboleth in the DSpace, and we provided a UI based on DiscoJuice, where you can actually see all the institutions listed. So if you are going to use the repository, you have to configure only the Shibboleth part, and you have to register with your identity provider. And then the rest of the things are taken care from the repository directly. You don't have to do much in the repository.
Is it declaring DiscoJuice, or is it a specific or local?
It's a standalone. It's local. But you can use also the Clarin one. The difference is that for our center, we are part of SPF, but we are also part of EduGain. Mm. And even though in Clarin Plus we are going to tackle this problem, that for the moment the Clarin DiscoJuice does not offer you EduGain entities. Okay, in Clarin Plus we are planning to have at least two variations for that, but that's why we use the standalone. And it seems to us, at least also for the users, because we have multiple applications behind one service provider, it seems for them, when we have asked them, that it's more user friendly. They see the page, they are not being redirected somewhere else. So that's those are two decisions why we chose this standalone. But using ClarinOne, there are centers using Lynda DSpace that use the CenterOne.
Mm-hmm. Then we also implemented the data protection code of conduct, which is one of the requirements for Clarin Center. So when the user first log in, we actually pop up with information that what we are going to use, what we are receiving from the identity provider, and how we are going to use it, if we are going to store any information or not. So we are very clear with the user that the information is this information is going to be used and how it is going to be used. Then, as I said, that we have provided a lot of features for the administrators. So, for example, it is very easy to trace any problems with the logins. So when you're using Shibboleth, there are a lot of problems. Sometimes the service identity provider is not actually sending all the information that is required to log in. So we have created control panel tabs that can actually give you easily access to the user logins, and you will see what is being sent from the to identity providers, and you can easily trace and then actually contact the user that you should contact back to your identity provider and ask for this information, and the QA is very easy. You don't have to go to the log files and see what's happening. You don't have to trace anything. Everything is directly from the UI of the DSpace.
I'm sorry, I'm going to interrupt you. For example, now I received an email, then somebody from Denmark tried to authenticate, but there was some issue because he changed it. Yeah, so not only in the control panel, but we also received these emails saying that somebody tried to log in and there were some issues and we can tackle that. So, yeah, thank you for the demonstration.
Yeah, so because previously it was very difficult because you have to go through all the logs, the user will contact you, the user didn't know what's happening, and then you have to go through all the logs to find out specifically what's happening, but now it's very easy. You will receive an email, you can actually look also into the control panel to see what's happening in the past few days. If somebody has any problems, you can solve it on your own. You can contact the user. And then we also developed some tools that can actually QA the service providers, and you can see from which IDPs you are getting which attributes, and you can actually do some QA based on that as well.
If you are more interested, there will be an AI session task force meeting, but you are all welcome to join. And I will show there a tool which helps us also on SPF level to get more attributes. So if you are interested, please join us after the lunch.
Yeah. So then there are basically submission workflow. So the submission workflow means that how you are going to process the information that the user will going to submit. So user will going to submit a item, then it can go to an editor or a curator, or it can go directly to the repository, how you will going to perform the QA. And all of this is actually configurable in DSpace. And from our experience, we have created some workflows that you can use, or you can actually edit, and you can add more stages in between if you want to separate the editors and the quality assurance, or you want to combine them, or you can edit all of this.
And edit means there are already actions that you have to just configure, or
yes.
Do you need a program?
Yeah, you can just configure the operations directly from the UI. And you can add more steps, or you can reduce the steps. What we did is we added some functionality that was not part of the DSpace. So for example, you can create a shareable workflow. You can actually change a collection after submission, which was not there in the DSpace. Or we have introduced more robust curation. You can directly curate item when the item is in the edit mode, and we have added more curation tasks.
basically the functionality is there in DSpace to begin with. So the DSpace is kind of, I think that's the main feature why we chose it in the beginning, that we wanted a repository that we can just start running and pretty much everything is there. Mm-hmm. So in the beginning, you know, preparatory phase when it was starting, our team was very, very small. It was three people, including the manager. So we wanted something that we will be able to keep running without big investment. And DSpace had most of the things as Amir mentioned in the beginning. So it's kind of ready-made package that includes the front end, and includes the submission workflow front end. And it also includes kind of clickable administrative interface where you just configure that this workflow will have this guy as an editor and this guy. And that workflow will have different set of metadata, and it will not go through the editing phase, but will be published directly. So you can basically click on these things in the web forms.
And are they more? There are all manual actions or whatever. It now goes to this person who has a look, or are there also like automatic checking quality control actions?
So basically, we are not using them, but there are also automated like hidden steps where it will go through something and either tell him, but we are not using those.
Mm-hmm. So but not, for example, validating the SIMD file that was uploaded.
Right. What we are doing is we still leave the user, the curator, to access that, and then he runs with one click a set of curation tasks. Okay. Which will tell him, okay, these URLs are there, they are valid, they can be reached at the moment, then yes, all the required fields are there, so we are performing this set of curation tasks with one click, all of them on that, but it's on the curator to decide what to do, how to write the message back to the user if he wants to reject or if he wants to add more information.
Okay, but it's not automatically run and that the collection manager just gets the report and he decides.
Could be, but it isn't currently in our configuration.
Exactly, and
but
moreover,
the
curator has to decide what to do next. So when he just clicks on that, then he can automatically just reject it, write that. So we would probably not change it even if we would get just emails, because he still has to click, he still has to, you know, see that maybe there is a user note which was written to explain some of the things. So he has to log into the web application. But I would like to add one more thing, that from the beginning the idea was to have a sustainable digital repository, exactly also what Pavel said. Almost everything, even a very, like you would say, complicated things, can be clicked in the UI. So without the programming knowledge, people can set the repository kind of and sustain it.
I actually think that this might be the key reason why it's the most popular repository system in the world. Yeah. It is run by many libraries, for instance, who do not have a programmer. Mm-hmm. So they are able to change the logos and then they keep it completely vanilla installation. I think most installations have very few modifications and they just are really, even the librarian is able to log in as an administrator and configure submission workflow for their PhD thesis and the different workflow for the books and keep it running. But I think a practical, maybe there will be some demo in the end anyway, but for instance, we now have two workflows, one for our data and a different one in the language resources inventory. And one workflow, when there is a new submission, an email comes to us, the Lindat administrators, to check the submission and confirm it. In the LRT inventory, it gets assigned, so it's a different submission, it gets assigned handles from the ERIC, not from us, different handle prefix. Mm-hmm. And the editor of that workflow is Dieter, not us. Mm-hmm. So these are the things that can be really configured just by clicking and choosing users from user base and say this guy will be editor of that workflow and so on.
Yeah, so these workflows are basically based on the collections. So you can define different workflows for each collection. So if an item is going to one collection, it will determine which workflow is associated with that collection, and then it will start running that workflow. And you can actually, for each step of the workflow, you can assign different users. So only those users will get notified that now it's your task to actually do the curation or the addition or the editor. So basically, you can define different collections, and then you can assign different groups of users to different tasks, which is very powerful because you don't need any programming. You just need some configuration, and you can directly do it from the UI. You don't even have to do any.
So does the user have to choose which collection they're submitting to to get into the right workflow?
Yep.
Is that ever a problem that they choose the wrong one and you end up with the wrong, following the wrong workflow?
It used to be in the very beginning. If you remember years ago, we started with DSpace where we were showing the collections and communities, and that was one of the complaints that we got in the beginning. That, what does it mean, the collections and communities, and why is it there? And it was also for searching and for browsing. You had to go through collections and communities hierarchy. And since the user feedback was, what is it good for, really? Then we kind of hide it a little bit now. So now it's not really a problem. Yeah.
Now we have really just two Innovate collections. One is the Lindat one. The second one is the language
LRT inventory.
Exactly, LRT
so
inventory.
Basically, the question in the beginning is, you try to make a submission and it says, okay, now you log in. And after you log in, basically you get a choice. I am the local guy from Prague, from Ufal. Mm-hmm. If not, then the other button is for you.
Yeah. So but at the end of the day, the curator gets it and he sees, and he can change it.
Yeah. So in the default DSpace, you cannot actually change once the user submitted. You cannot change from there. But we have provided this feature that you can change the collection as an editor. Yeah.
The reason I was asking that, but if they've gone down the wrong route, if you just change it, have you collected the right information from them? Is it a different workflow?
Depends. Yeah. That's a very good question. But there, most of the time, we have not required or so many different required fields. So not always, that's true, but many times you could do it, but actually we haven't experienced this in years.
Do we even have difference in the schema or not?
There is, based on the types, okay. At least. Based on the collections, no. Based on the types, yes. So at the moment, actually, Pavel is right, we don't have differences between collections. We have differences in metadata between actual types, which is the second question.
So when you are submitting into one collection or the other, we're still using the same metadata schema. Yeah. So we are actually using just one metadata schema in our repository. It's that simple in our use case. That really differs for different.
Yeah, but if you have different ones, you'd have to be careful to make sure that users go down the right route, I guess.
Yeah, I guess. If we have, for instance, a different collection for publications at some time, it will be a really different schema. Then it wouldn't.
So, what can really happen if someone is someone choose the wrong collection? It will go to a different editor, and then he will see, okay, this is not my item. He will change the collection, and then the other person will notify that, okay, it's now in the new collection, and you can do that.
As an editor, I sometimes don't confirm the, regardless of the reason. Sometimes it happens that people do not fill the metadata I like, or they do something that I think it's not great as they submitted it. So there's a functionality built into DSpace where I, with an editor role, I take it as an editor, I check, verify what I need to verify, and then I simply do not push the publish button, but I push the button of reject, and I write a reject message. That does not mean they have to redo everything. They can resubmit the same thing, just make the correction that I asked for. So it's kind of a good, quick feedback loop.
Yeah.
Can improve the
thing. So another thing that we implemented is that in the control panel now you can actually see the progress of the unfinished item. So if a person is submitting an item in the middle, you can actually see at which step the submission is now. And you can actually see the progress of all the items, and you can see if the item is rejected, if the item is still not submitted, and you can actually monitor all of this. So now comes the part of the submission, actual submission process. So we have actually reinvented basically we work a lot on the UI of the submission, because we really want the user to feel at ease, and we don't want them to get away by getting afraid from so many metadata fields. So we try to simplify the look as much as possible and make it intuitive. User should know at which step he is and how much steps left. So we created this intuitive progress bar where it is very clear that how many steps the user has to go, which steps is what. And then we provided a lot of autocomplete features. So if user is there is some information which is already there, it will pop up and you don't have to fill it again, you can just choose that. We also implemented the integration with OpenAir. So if you are selecting a sponsor which is in the OpenAir, you can actually get the list of those projects and you can select that, and then it will be directly used by the OpenAir. You don't have to do anything separate for that. All the metadata that is required by OpenAir will be automatically filled. Then there is proper validation of the forms. You can get nice messages. You can see what exactly is missing that you need to fill. And this. Then we have worked a lot on the upload file page. You can get nice dialog boxes of the progress of the file that you can upload. And we have also now supporting very large files, which is very difficult to upload. So we have developed a separate functionality for that, that you can, you cannot directly upload a file, but you can contact an administrator, and then we can actually take the file from you, and we can upload it from the local machine. So we have a functionality that is for administrators, that you can actually just give a path on the local machine, and then it will upload the file from there. So we are now supporting large files as well. Recently, we even submitted files bigger than 100 GB, and people downloaded that, and it's working.
Good.
Yeah.
Maybe I would like to add two things. So first of all, there is also a technical limitation to upload only files up to 2 GB, but we knew about that, and we also decided that if people want to upload more than 2 GB, it has to go through additional like approval, so they have to contact us and say, we have a 70 GB file. You are not going to upload that through the web application, through the web form. So usually they give us a link, we download it locally to the server, and then we, as admins, give put that file to their submission. That's the first step. And the second thing what we have implemented just recently is that if you want to download the 70 GB file, it also doesn't make sense to serve it by the repository, because you are missing the resumable downloads and a lot of features which the normal web server provides. And that's why we have a functionality where you say, okay, is this file really large? So you can just, in the user interface again, add some metadata, and it will be served by the web HTTP server. You can do that only for files which are not authorized, which do not require like signing a license, explicit signing a license. But most of the bigger files, or for us, all of the files which are big, are in a way publicly available. But this is what we are doing, and it saves a lot of resources and provides a lot of new interesting functionality. So you close the browser, you just get there again, and you can resume the download. If it's 70 GB, that makes a lot of sense.
It's a technicality, but it was a bit of a problem, right? That when it was being served by Tomcat, directly by this Java application.
These are other.
Is Tomcat not supporting this part of the HTTP protocol?
So it is, but not this space is not supporting these resumable downloads, because it has to some, you know, fiddling with the headers. And it's the support is not actually it's implemented there, but it's not being used because it's not done properly. And moreover, even if Tomcat would serve it, Tomcat was not meant to serve some gigabyte file or
that's what I was going to say, that it seemed to be taking like 100% CPU.
That's more of a DSpace like thing, but still Tomcat was not meant for serving these static files in a way.
Whereas now we use Nginx, right? But basically any other HTTP server you have set up. Yeah.
But this
does that much more fluently and elegantly with much less load. And
these are some other implications which at the moment is against our policy, but you can add there any other link to your own cloud, to your whatever. Okay, but then you would have a problem in synchronizing the copies, but still the functionality is there, and it
can be
exploited.
We use OwnCloud, or at least the MPI is using OwnCloud in our setup for actually getting users to upload big files. They can use the OwnCloud to make it, so that we don't have to, in our implementation, deal with all the getting big files over.
But this is exactly what we also offer to the user. We tell the user, okay, give us a link, you have to have it somewhere, usually they have it available, but you can also, here is our storage layer on Linda, you can upload it there, and we can just download it from there. So,
okay,
yeah,
so what we do is they get it. While they're doing in a submission process, they are having a workspace on the server.
Ah, okay.
And that can pretend, that is then, they are logged in already, so it's tied to their user, it has size limitation, so they cannot upload whatever, then you would still go through the
right, so we have this exactly.
And then basically you can drag and drop from your own cloud environment.
Yeah. But then you really do copy it into the repository storage, and then you are in the same situation when somebody wants to download it.
That's
you have to somehow handle the big download from the repository.
Yeah. We haven't looked at that.
Just a quick question. These large files, are they stored in an external kind of storage from the repository and just linked to, or are they downloaded into the central?
So there is something called the asset store. It's basically a directory on the file system.
Yeah.
And inside that, DSpace knows which file is being checksummed. So we need to have that file. We want to have that file locally because it's being really safely deposited, checksummers being computed regularly, some other consistency checks are being made. That's why I said that if you would serve it from OwnCloud, you still have to have your own copy, because you know, if you don't control OwnCloud, somebody can change that. That's exactly what we want to prevent. When you have a digital repository, you should know what's there. If somebody changed it or just created a new version, there are policy issues, and moreover, if you change that, we record it in the metadata. We exactly know what has happened, the history and everything.
So basically the repository is the relational database with metadata, but that's not where the data is. Data is in an asset store, so separate storage that is only for the repository.
Yeah.
And if I'm not mistaken, it can be done many different ways.
Yeah.
It doesn't necessarily have to be local file system.
Yeah.
But by default, and in our installation, it's just local file system with directories that are linked to the records in the metadata.
So DSpace completely manages the data streams?
Yes. DSpace completely manages the files in the
Fedora system. You can say basically you can have Fedora basically having the metadata and all the checksums and so on, but you could still determine externally where the files go. And for the big files we are actually looking at, you can also point that basically, until now we pointed with the file and then Fedora just serves it to the Tomcat, but you can also use basically have an Apache behind and then the Fedora proxies it, so the Tomcat, and then you could send over the partial HTTP request, so the resumable downloads and so on. We are a bit experimenting there.
But still, at the end of the day, you know, the Tomcat was not more meant for that. But exactly, with DSpace, first of all, we also don't have it really locally. We have some shared disks, so it's being on a shared file system, whatever. But DSpace, as its own, provides some external places. Like it can be also used with Amazon S3 services and some others, but Lynda DSpace at the moment has been tested only with a local file system.
Yeah, so the next thing is licensing. So this is one of the things that we have really worked a lot over the period of, you know, few years, because we have noticed that one of the difficulties for the user is to choose the proper license. So we have created our own licensing framework first of all, and then we have actually created a tool, a JavaScript-based utility that you can not only use in this repository but anywhere else, because it's a standalone project which actually guides the user which license to select. So in DSpace there are basically two licenses. One is the distribution license that the user has to give to the repository, that the repository will going to distribute these resources. So we have really make it very visible that which license you have to choose and which you have to accept. And once the user will accept, start using, user will choose which license, there is a nice, easy to use form which will ask few questions to guide the user to the right license. So this is actually a separate project which you can actually use elsewhere as well if you want to use a license framework somewhere. Then for the licensing framework, we have again control panel tabs in which you can define the licenses, and you can also control the metadata related to the license. You can control when the user signed the license, you want every time the user to log in, or you want the signing just to happen the first time the user downloaded a resource. You can also control whether you want extra information for a particular license. So all of this is now part of our DSpace and very easy to control. And on the administration level, you can see actually which user downloaded which files, which license is signed, which information is provided by the user, and you can easily see this in one tab and do that. So basically, when a user will come and he wants to search for a resource, we also have worked on that a lot. We have developed the whole search page from the scratch. So in the DSpace, it's not that intuitive. We have added a lot of functionality in the searching. So there are now facets. We have created our own displaying scheme of the items. So it's very easy to search. There are like quick filters that you can use. You can just select top authors, top topics and things like that, and the results will be very nicely shown on one page, and you can go through with that. Then because it's all metadata and you can harvest that, so your repository can be easily harvested by other repositories. For example, the VLO can harvest from your repository. It can be indexed in the Thomas Reuters data index or OLAC in Google Scholar. Anyone can use your metadata, and it's widely available. So if a user is going to submit a resource in this repository, it will be automatically available in all other repositories that are linked or harvesting from your repository. So the availability will be much wider using this. And other thing that we actually implemented, and it's one of the nice features, is that we really put a lot of importance of on citing. So we created a ref box, we call it ref box, in which you can actually get a clear message that what is the resource, which text you need for citing this resource. Because this is one of the problems, that when somebody wants to use a resource, there is only the URL, which is not a nice way to cite the resource. So we actually created a very nice refbox in which you can get all the necessary information for citing, and you can actually convert into different formats. So there is BibTeX, you can click, you can get the BibTeX format, you can click, you can get the CMD format, and then also you can share the resource on social media. So we have integrated different social media platforms. You can just click and it will be shared on the social media. So this is all part of our repository, and this is also a separate project, so you can use this functionality. You just have to provide a handle and it will contact the OLAC and get the information and can display a refbox anywhere else as well apart from this repository. Then we also include another feature in this refbox, which is integration, because a lot of time your resources are not only part of the repository, but they're also part of some other services. For example, we have a service called Context, in which they are corpora. So the corpora is also in the repository, but it is also in another service. So you can actually add all those services directly into the item view. So a user will search an item, he will click and see the details of the item, and directly from there you can actually go to the other services, and it's very easy and configurable, and you can use this feature.
So basically this is in a way what the Clarin switchboard, just the basic functionality, but you have a data set and you can see where it's being used. So the switchboard does it automatically, whatever, but this is our integration from the repository itself. So these are our tools, and we also try to connect those tools together. So there is a cycle. When you go to PMLTQ, you see that the file can be downloaded from repository. The same goes for Context. You are in Context, you are having a fun with corpora, then you are also presented with a link to the repository where you can download it if you are interested. So this whole cycle of...
It's been something we've been working on for a while now, and we are looking for ways to improve it, basically. Somehow keep track of all the instantiations of the same data set in different tools, in different ways, and linking between them. Sometimes by allowing you to switch, sometimes directly linking between data sets. But basically, I think that it's a feature of most linguistic data sets, that they can have different ways of using them, different instances. Sometimes you need to change formats to have it in some tool in particular. So maybe sometimes you can do it automatically, but very often you can't. And very often once it's available, it doesn't make sense for other people to go through the same process. So we have some kind of like static instances of the data set already ready-made in a particular interface and so on. So there are copies. It's not like you move it from the repository into the search interface. It's already a copy of somehow processed data set ready in different places, in different services, and link between those.
Mm-hmm. All of this is nicely put together in an item view. So you can see the metadata, you can see the beta streams, and for example, we have nice icons for all the different types of beta streams. We have, for example, support for downloading multiple files together in a zip format. You can configure that. There are messages that, for example, file is large, so it can take time or things like that. So everything is nicely put together. The licensing information is very visible. The citing information is very visible. All the metadata is very visible. And everything is packaged in a very nice look and feel. Another feature is that, for example, if there is a new version of the item, so the old item is already in the repository, you can replace the item with the new one. The admin can just add a new metadata and link it to the new one. So the old item will show you a message that there is a newer version of the item is available. So just click and go to that, or you want to download the same one that's there. Then we also integrated statistics. So there is Google Analytics available, and then we also integrated PIVIC. So PIVIC is integrated seamlessly out of the box. You don't have to do anything, just configure a PIVIC server and provide the details. And from the DSpace part, it will be automatically sending information to the PIVIC, and we have nice graphs which user can see, and then we also generate monthly PIVIC reports that user can subscribe, and it will be sent by emails in a PDF format to the users. So as I already mentioned, that one of the things that we have really worked on is the control panel, the monitoring for the administration part. And we have a lot of control panel tabs that are part of our implementation that are directly usable. For example, for logging, you can see if the logs are generating properly, what are generating in the logs. If there are errors, it will be very prominent, visible. You don't have to log into to the machine to see that. You can directly see in the control panel from the UI. Then there are the tabs for logins. You can see who is logged in. If there is any problem in the login of the user, you can see that. You can see, for example, the whole view of the bitstreams. You can see all the bitstreams in the repository. You can change the format of the bitstreams. Then, as I said, that you can monitor the progress of the unfinished items, and then there are lots of other tabs available. You can create your own tabs. A new feature that we have recently added is a share workflow. So, for example, if I started a submission, and I want some of the part to be taken care of by another person, so I will just share the submission. It will generate a link. I will give the link to the other person, and he can continue from there with the submission. So this is a new feature that we added. We also added previews of the bitstream. So for example, if there is a zip file and you want to see what's inside the zip file, it will just give you a preview. So without downloading the file, you can actually see the preview.
So this is a little bit to your previous question. Sometimes we do some automatic processing of the data. Mm. So whenever somebody submits a zip file, we do check that it actually is a valid zip archive that opens, and we take index of that zip file and make it available as a preview.
Mm. I'm checking the checksums for all of the contents, or
that is done by default,
yeah,
in DSpace for all of the content.
Mm.
But it creates a checksum of every file that is submitted.
And on a weekly basis, we iterate doing the checksum, but also consistency checks.
Mm-hmm. But there are lots of other features related to bitstreams that are part of the DSpace that you can use. We are using some of them. So, for example, you can have different processors for different type of files, and you can generate indexes based on the content which is inside the bitstreams.
Screenshots,
yeah,
of PDF,
yeah,
files, the first file, virus scanner, if you have that, but we are not using those.
So, but the basic functionality that you can define what happens with any file type that is submitted, that's in there.
Mm-hmm.
So there are some built-in processors like extracting plain text of PDF,
yeah,
and indexing it for content search. So that then the front end search is also inside the PDFs or Microsoft Docs, and you can easily write your own processors of particular file types.
Yeah.
We will probably do it in future. Once we have more time, then we have all kinds of plans to, I don't know, previews, different typical linguistic files, you know, but. That is one of the areas where it would be great to get some cooperation of other centers. So if somebody has lots of TEIP5 documents, they can create a previewer of these in some form. We have a lot of syntactically annotated tree banks. Maybe we will do some previews of those files. Who knows? But the functionality to work in this area is there. And we started with a simple thing that seems to be useful, previewing content of archives.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, then there is localization, so you can actually localize the whole DSpace in your language. So if you're going to use our DSpace, you will get check as complimentary. But you can actually use that workflow to actually define your own message files, and you can write your own strings, and then it will be automatically there.
I'll permit my Swedish.
So maybe just a few comments to this. So because Lynda DSpace has been installed in multiple centers already, we have gone through the localization part through something we call the overlays, because there are a lot of pages mentioning Lynda. So for example, in Slovenia, they have done really like rebranding for their own center, so you will see no mentioning of Lynda or very Slovenian content unless they explicitly wanted to mention that it was based on Lynda DSpace. So all the pages, we have invested some time into allowing this, but all the pages can be changed for particular center, including the localization. The localization, I mean the user part, not, for example, the administrator part. The administrator will be always in English. At the moment, DSpace has thousands of messages to translate. So unless for your language there is already a translation, it would take many, many hours. For example, in Slovenia, if they would have to translate all the messages, it would take days and days. But when we showed them what to translate, it was done in hours. Still, it took quite some time, but in hours, the user interface for the user was localized.
Is it possible to integrate with something like Poodle or some, your language resource labels and kind of the translations?
I'm sorry?
Is it possible to integrate with something like Poodle, like a translation, basically a platform where you can do translations with all these labels? How do you do it right now?
Right. So at the moment, it's like DSpace is doing that. It's in. It's actually it's using. Well, it's using messages.xml. So in XML, you have to go and translate that.
Yeah.
So there is no external application you can at the moment use which would generate that, or not straightforward way how to do that. Okay. So there are some, well,
that's integrated.
Yeah, so it's a manual way.
Yeah, for check localization, we just gave the XML file to a translator. Mm. She opened it in an XML editor and did it.
But
there's a lot.
Yeah, but DSpace has the check localization, so we only translated the new things added by us, which were maybe tens or, I don't know, 100 strings or so. And that was kind of easy.
Closer to
yeah, but there the DSpace, because it has been used all over the world, more than 1,000 installation, they have pretty good localized. They have a lot of languages are already there, and it's kind of localized. Maybe not perfectly, but applicable.
Mm-hmm. So
we have 10 minutes.
Yeah, as Pavel said, that Joseph said that we our DSpace is already used in different client centers. So this is the one that is Lynda client which we implemented. Then our implementation is also used in Norway, Poland, Slovenia, and also in Italy, and in a couple of other sites as well.
The presentation was before Spragan, but also in Sweden, and they are actually working on it in Spain and in other countries, but we will
on
see.
On which version of this space that is based?
5.6, unreleased version. At the moment, the official version is 5.5, but we are on 5.6.
And so about using this APIs for this space, is there a way that we can use APIs to access data from
the so there is a REST based API which we are also using, like the RefBox you have seen, it's using REST API, so there's another web application.
Or even because from version 5 you can write to repository.
Yes, it's there. It's part of Lynda DSpace because it's part of DSpace. It's also part of Lynda DSpace, okay. And we are also actively using that.
But there are some limits, of course, on, for instance, creating, if you want to create new records via the REST API, we haven't really done that. So
because our plan is to that application can use REST API to write something to repository and then to use data from the repository with API.
Yeah. So we haven't tested it, but it's possible, and DSpace is using that, the newest version of DSpace using REST API.
We're also working with that to get it into our workflows.
But there are things like the additional steps, especially the licensing. So, you know, how to do the authorization and license signing automatically via REST API over Shibboleth. How do you present the license to it? So that, I think that's the limitation of using the automatic workflows in general. So technically speaking, it is there, the API is there, you can use it. So one of the options that we've been thinking about, but haven't done anything with it, is you might have a different submission workflow that is not within DSpace for something simple. Or if you have, I don't know, publications on your web page or in a different system, you can actually move that.
This is for the DSpace part.
REST API. Perfect, yeah.
And about sustainability, about following this space, do you have any plans for future? How far will you get with it? So now you are following version 5.0.
We're pretty much following this space where it goes. So.
Okay, so for this, there is a major change in the DSpace. At the moment, they are offering two user interfaces, which is the XML UI we are based on and the JSP. They decided to merge into one, completely new one. So if you ask whether we are going to change to version 6, yes, because version 6 is still having both UI supported. Then there will be version 7, which will have a completely new UI. However, that doesn't mean that the XML UI will stop working. That only means that it will no longer be totally supported by DSpace. For us, it really does not matter so much because we are supporting our user interface by ourselves. But we don't know what to do or when it's going to be officially released, we will to decide. But this means year, maybe two in the future. But for the moment, we are really on the newest one. DSpace 6 we will probably upgrade to, but in some time it hasn't been released yet, so.
We are rather confident it will work out nicely because we've had this situation before. We were on an older version of DSpace for years, and the DSpace was going on through next versions, and we were keeping the current one, sometimes backporting particular new functionality. And then we did upgrade a few years later. It was basically a smooth process.
But it has taken some time. There is one more thing. We really try hard to put new functionality we have created for DSpace back to DSpace. So now in DSpace 6, or already I think it's 5.6, we have something called weekly health checks. So it's already part of the core DSpace. The controllable panel, it's already part of DSpace. And many other features are already part of DSpace thanks to us. So what we really try to slowly put them, the functionality, so they will take care of that because the community really likes that. And
that makes our maintenance more manageable if some of the functionality becomes part of the core DSpace. It's a good thing to do for the community, and it's also a good thing to do for us if somebody else needs things.
Have you done that? Just like submitted pull requests through GitHub?
Exactly, but there is like a more complicated process because, you know, usually those are not smaller features, so they have to know about it, they have to want it. okay, because then they have to support it. So usually the process takes some time, and now because of the major change that they are going to change to new UI, there were some also changes in that, and they stopped really getting new features, and in version 7 we will restart our efforts.
But so far the things you mentioned have been accepted by this space. And the one thing that they've been talking about for some time is the licensing part. That there's been some interest in the space community, but nothing is finished yet.
A quick question for the break. Is if you've got a centers or existing repositories or collections of data, you want to get that all into DSpace quickly. Do you have experience with that, or workflows?
Well, we did the LRT inventory import. That was the biggest collection of about 1,000 records.
Yeah.
So it depends on what's the input format. Mm-hmm. There are multiple ways, quite a few, how to put data automatically to DSpace. There are easy ones and there are more complex ones. So you have to tell me what's the input format.
Yep.
And then we can.
But generally speaking, there are other ways than click through the form to get
sure.
Things
like
that.
And if the end of the day, REST API. I'm sorry.
Well, so I've got an example. Yeah. If we wanted to use it, we've got about 65,000 items, and they've all got TEI XML, P5 XML headers.
So in this case. Depends on what the TI, what would you like to use from that. The most basic solution would be extract the required information from TI, create on the file system by like very easy but very specific files, and then just run the import for importing.
So basically, did you have metadata? All the metadata directly in the TEI files, or do you have some other metadata somewhere else? Okay, so then it would be exactly as Josef said.
Mm-hmm.
Basically create a text file with metadata and put TEI as the bitstream as something people can download next to it, and then it gets imported together into DSpace, where the metadata from the specialized metadata file would go into the database, and the text file would be included as a bitstream.
Yeah. I mean, actually, another thing we want to do is do a crosswalk from these TI headers to SIMDI. We haven't got a SIMDI metadata at the moment.
We generated. Maybe
so.
Be a moment to show.
So there are other options. Do you have already a repository which, for example, offers OAI PMH? If yes, that could be one place how to import. Then through the metadata, so there are a lot of ways how to get it. The question is what kind of information you would like to store in the DSpace, or if you choose what we discussed at the beginning, just the mandatory information in DSpace and then offer using OAI PMH the CMDI or something like that. There are really a couple of questions you would have to answer yourself what really you would like to have. But before the break, if I just would like to Amir to demonstrate one thing. So just, you know, there was an email from Mitchell that he cannot log in. So can you reset his net ID? So the reason is that we are gathering two things. Is it okay for you? It will be
sure.
Maybe,
yeah.
Your email will be maybe shown on the camera.
Yeah.
Okay. So now Amir is authenticating to our repository and he's an administrator, so he will have on the right panel a lot of issues, so he can access control people. So now these are a lot of people, just about search for Seaton, S-E-A-T-O-N. Okay, so we have this user, which is sitting here. And the thing was that he changed his email or the net ID changed.
The a different ID from the IDP.
Exactly. So this is what is really needed. So reset that, and now you should be able to log in. You can verify if you want.
Yeah.
But this is what we call the sustainable. So no need to go to the database or something like that. Just clicking. A normal user would will hopefully be able to do that.
So this whole access control, that's a DSpace thing that you just locked from DSpace.
So I know that
where you create, you can click to create a new group and just point people in the forum to be part of a group, and then you assign some function in some workflow to that group. For instance, these are the editors of that workflow or something. So that in this respect, that this is what we talked about before, that it is kind of nicely manageable by pretty much anybody.
Yeah.
Okay, so thank you for this session. We can definitely discuss more in the next session. It will be more related to the Clarinby assessment. But if you have any questions, I don't want to steal the break from you, the coffee. So
but we can discuss over coffee.
Yeah, sure.